So now what we'll be moving to a panel around the EV charging ecosystem and how the EV charging ecosystem is building out the EV infrastructure. We have four speakers today on our panel. We have Boris Polania from Honda, Julian Lyle from Tritium, Ed Lewis from Arrive, and Giles Shrimpton from Cygic. Hello, everyone.
Hello.
Hey, John.
Let's see. Do we have everyone on the? There we go. Great. So why don't we go ahead and go around and do a really quick introduction and tell us a little bit about your company.
Sure, I'll go first. My name is Julian Lyle at Tritium Charging, and we do design and manufacture high power fast chargers throughout the world. We have over 4,500 fast chargers globally deployed, and we have offices in Brisbane, Amsterdam, and LA. And before that, I was previously at EVgo. I spent 3 years there working on our OEM public fast charging network deals.
Great. Ed?
Hi, everybody. I'm Ed Lewis. I lead business development for Arrive, which is a last mile mobility provider. We have a set of APIs that sit on top of parking and EV infrastructure throughout North America. And those APIs are connected into big partner consumer experiences, whether that be you're using Apple App Clip to pay for parking, you're in a vehicle like a GM or a Hyundai or any of the top OEMs, or you're buying a ticket to a concert or a show on Ticketmaster, and our APIs are powering that in-car experience. So we work with every parking operator across North America, have tens of thousands of locations that we bring mobility to, and we're excited to give you some signal on where EV is being added into the mix.
Great. Thanks, Ed. Giles?
Hi,
Giles.
John. I'm Managing Director Automotive for Cygic, and the mother company is called Eurovag. What's relevant in terms of EV, we have a lot of activities. We are actually a payment institute, so we offer lots of different payment mechanisms. But with Cygic, we have the leading freemium navigation application on the market, which includes EV functionality. We also have integrated EV functionality. We have a fleet management system, so we've integrated into our fleet management system. And we recently made a strategic investment in a Dutch company called Last Mile Solution, which offer the leading software backbone for charge point operators and mobility service providers in Europe.
Great. Thanks for joining us. Boris?
Hey, my name is Boris Polania. I work for Honda. I am in the CEB department. We've been working in electrification of vehicles, EVSEs, standards, and stuff like that. Yes, I've been working a few years here.
Thank you. So as you can see, we have a collection of viewpoints and folks from the EV ecosystem. And so what I wanted to start with is really a question around, we're now going to see a lot of new first-time buyers. There's been a lot of commitment to EV and the growth of EV vehicles. So what are some of the tools that are going to help facilitate this behavior change? We're going to see a lot of new first-time customers. So what are some of those tools? What are you all working on to help bring make EV more simple for the the new first-time buyer?
Yeah, I'll start. I think that from an infrastructure perspective, the industry is looking at building fast chargers in public retail locations. So a little bit different than gas stations, where you purposely go to the gas station to fill up for gas. Infrastructure is being deployed in areas that you'd be going to anyways, and almost kind of as an amenity. So, you know, you go to your Starbucks, you go to your Targets or grocery stores, you can just drive right up to your fast charger, get your groceries in 20 or 30 minutes while your car is charging, and then you're able to drive back home with a battery that's a little bit more fuller than when you started off for your trip. So I think that's, you know, building in convenient locations is definitely where the industry is heading from an infrastructure perspective.
Ed, your thoughts on this? Yep. I know that you guys build a lot of, you know, I think Arrive is really actually known for your parking API. So would love to know more what you're doing on EV.
Yeah, so new vehicle buyers are really being asked to figure out on their own a dumpster fire of complexity here. You know, it's an amazing fragmentation in a fast growing industry, you know, a lot of resource being thrown at range anxiety and increasing the supply of chargers. I think the upward trends are all going the right direction. I think the risk from a consumer standpoint, I'll use a term. So Amazon's an investor in our company, and we get put through the paces on a monthly basis in design reviews. And the term that they always bring back on one of their ethos is, how can you enhance a consumer's trust with every interaction? And I think the real risk here in the situation in the EV charging industry is we're set up for this to be what Amazon calls a trust buster. So someone ventures and buys their first EV vehicle, and we're relying on them to do the work to figure out where they charge, how they charge, how they pay. There's just so much fragmentation in the industry. So we're looking to bring a level of SLAs to EV charging for the first time. And that'll happen inside of downtown urban cores and really supplement what's happening with home charging.
Yeah, it's actually a good question. In terms of users that are charging at home, what does that number look like? What is the percentage of public charging versus at home EV charging? I got to imagine
it's going to be pretty consistent over time, according to projections. I think somewhere between 20 to 30% of people won't have access to home charging, whether they don't purchase one or get it financed by the OEM, or their living situation doesn't allow them to have their own charger if they're in a shared condo building or something like that. I think the majority of people will have charging at home, but there's the other quarter of the population. And then, you know, John, what we talk about is this, how people are going to be looking to snack on EV charging, no different than, you know, they look to top off the fuel on their vehicle when it's convenient to.
Yeah, I got to imagine it. In some cases, it doesn't impact somebody at all. Say a commuter who plugs in every day, drives to work, comes back, and does that. And then there are, but as there's growth within the EV community and people want to use their cars, kind of more, maybe in the way that they expect or anticipated with a regular internal combustion vehicle, they're going to be surprised, or they'll come as Will put earlier, that spotlight moment when they're trying to use a public infrastructure for maybe the first time, or decide to take a longer trip, and the confusion will set in terms of how that vehicle is used. So Giles, maybe you can give us a bit of the European perspective and how that looks today.
Yeah, so in terms of what we're working on, clearly it's a very complex picture, but what we work on is we work on the mobile apps and the telemetry in cars. So one of the key issues is in terms of improving the reliability of the EV range when you're actually driving. And that's a mixture of some very complex internal factors in terms of the car and external factors like traffic and gradient and all these and driving speed and all these sorts of things. And then we take that and we put that into a routing algorithm that allows you to find your optimum charging locations. And within that, again, it's a complex story because you have different plugs and charging times and all this sort of stuff. So it's actually finding the right location, the right location being available, and then your actual charging experience when you get to the location. And one of the keys, in a sense, is also the convenience of payment and also the transparency of payment. You know, how much are you going to pay? Because there's actually a huge difference. So that's kind of what we are working on in terms of trying to fundamentally ensure that the driver gets a actually finds the public charging point and gets a good experience when he gets there. And that's also one of the reasons why we invested in Last Mile Solution, which is kind of working on the backbone to actually improve this area in the industry.
Great. So Julian, are you seeing a lot of growth in you supply EV chargers to the ecosystem? How does the growth look like for the next 2 years? Are you guys really busy with deployments and expanding growth?
Oh yeah, I mean it's EVs are like the new cool thing now. So yeah, growth is huge, both for light duty vehicles and medium heavy duty vehicles as well. Specifically with the OEMs trying to kind of figure out. OEMs and networks, charge point operators trying to figure out how to monetize these things. So, I mean, from an OEM perspective, there's kind of two different parts where the industry is, I feel, moving in the next couple of years. One is making sure their vehicles are compatible with the different charging technologies out there. I think someone said earlier that, you know, the industry is very fragmented. So what that means is there's a lot of different hardware suppliers out there and a lot of different OEMs, and making sure that all the pieces of the puzzle fit at the various different types of equipment that's available is a huge thing. So making sure that our chargers are compatible with every OEM is a big initiative. And then the other thing is, it's kind of a chicken and the egg thing where you need public charging to sell electric vehicles, but you also need electric vehicles to fund public charging. So it's, OEMs are spending a lot of resources on funding networks such as, you know, EVgo and ChargePoint and some of these other networks they actually compensate them to build infrastructure throughout the country to make more EV infrastructure available for potential car buyers.
Yeah, I think we talked about earlier, so the 15 or 15118 charging standard. So can you explain that to our audience?
Yeah, I mean, basically the 101 versions of 15118 is a basically your vehicle has a unique identification number, almost like a VIN number. And when you plug in your CCS port or your CHAdeMO port into the vehicle, it automatically knows your VIN or your number, your unique identifier number is automatically read, and you can be billed at the same time. So you don't have to type in an account number. You don't have to log into anything. Your vehicle will literally know it's you charging, and then it bills your credit card automatically.
Great. Hey, Boris, have you spent any time with
15118? Yeah. And yeah, we but it's a broad, you know, subject in the subject of IDs. I agree with Julien. We are facing in general the issue if that number constitutes a PII, right? And if that what will mean in terms of, you know, GDPR and stuff like that, dealing with that number. We face similar issue with the VIN number when they change to GDPR. So that's one of the consideration and identification on the vehicle. And that influences how powerful the EVSC is, right? What kind of information the EVSC will gather when communicating with the vehicle. Vision 11.8 seems to be, you know, heading to be the standard. It's still, you know, lacking some adoption, or people is not 100% being convinced. Not on the merits of 11.8. It's just if it's worth moving from, especially the ones that have been doing V1G, trying to, when they're thinking V2G, if it's worth switching to 15118, but I think like with all technology, eventually they will switch. I think it would be a little slower than initially thought. And then, you know, you have to consider the upstream, right? So if 15118 is EVSC to EV, then you have to go, especially for V2G, that I think V2G is, I think, should be the one of the benefits that you can bring to add value to users, right? You can get it to the VSC can be this centralized, let's call it middleware, so you can add your home and your solar array and participate in incentives with the utility and all that thing. But then you have to communicate up, right? And so this is OCPP 2035. So this mix of protocols when coming up from the utility, from the aggregator, from the charge point operator to 15118 or to, you know, Chatham or something, it has its technical difficulties. And I think it's going to be, especially in California, where the utility requires to be working in 2035. It will add a lot of technical layers and obstacles on the long term, but eventually I think it will happen. But I expect like these little things, like the ID number is PII, or how can you really use the identification number to process payments without making the VSC PCI compliant, stuff like that, right? And yeah, it's not clear. And at the beginning I thought, you know, we are not the ones that have it, the OEMs in general doesn't have it clear. So
Are there any other standards or data formats or protocols that the folks who are building EV systems should be aware of?
I think in 2035, IEEE 2035 is the one to watch, because California in California Rule 21 requires the operator, the utility, sorry, to use 2035 to communicate with the aggregators. So that makes it you have to deal with it. And how the DVSC or the charge port operator deals with it, it matters. And then what OCPP is been, you know, for V1G, a common standard, and they're moving to 2.0, and it's also something. And then the SAE family of standards, I think they are also, you need to get acquainted if you want to, you know, to deal with this integration in V2G. I'm talking V2G, right? But it's right now a complex environment, I tell you, especially if you add SAE to the mix. It's hard to clearly see where the industry is going. And beyond California, I think California is the only one enforcing the protocol. So I expect other utilities still keep using open EDRs on other stuff, but in California they have to switch to IEEE 2035. So if you're planning to go deep into V2G and enrolling users in, you know, programs, I will get a 2035 expert to get acquainted with it, because it's kind of new and it has a lot of nuances. California Edison is starting a public demo, and they are trying to, you know, get people on board in this, but it will take time and it will be technically non-trivial.
Yeah. So Ed, as you're beginning to build out part of services that are connected to parking, how are you dealing with some of the new standards? How are you dealing with that maybe you'll have to rewrite your API a number of times in order to support that?
Yeah, so John, today EV charging is really focused on discovery. So you're asking consumers to drive somewhere to charge, and they're hoping when they get there, it's available, it's easy to pay for, it's somewhat close to what they're intending to do with their day. We're addressing what we think is the bigger problem or more complex problem, that if it's really solved, it becomes magical, which is convenience-based charging. So you're not driving out of your way. It's using APIs that we and others have built tied to where you're headed. So you're not driving out of your way and really tapping into these 2 to 6 hour dwell times that we all have as part of our life. We're going to dinner, we're going to a business appointment, we're going to a doctor's appointment, we're going to a concert or a game. And you can not only park a convenient place, but you can also have EV added to that in one payment bundle, really to unlock that. Obviously, we've got to do the work with the parking operator, which includes, you know, at this stage, we're adding level 2 chargers in. These aren't, the same infrastructure that's needed for a longer charge at home. And those will be the appropriate standard. And, you know, really, we're intending to deliver SLAs to really remove the mystery in this market. Because this is on private land, we can unlock this space for the first time and have it be with occupancy sensing to know if it's actually available. We can have it enforced if someone is staying too long, and have all that bubble up via the same APIs into our availability and payments flow, which ultimately uses cards on file that OEMs have in place and uses wayfinding that OEMs are also have in place. So we've got some work ahead of us, John, but the intention is to leverage the same consumer flows that the OEMs are building today in terms of wayfinding and payments, and power them with this new capability.
And Giles, you're in a bit of the same space, but you also own part of that wayfinding capability with Sygic as the map. How are you looking at how are you looking at the infotainment side of things? How are you looking at bringing customers to that capacity?
We in Sygic have a very kind of flexible mobile application that you can either mirror or you can kind of download. Most of the OEs today are kind of creating their own kind of walled garden application stores. So we can actually integrate our mobile application into that environment, and that actually integrates into the infotainment system. And because of that design, it means it's a bit like an over-the-air update. You can actually update regularly the stuff. Because one of the keys in this infrastructure is what we know is it's highly complex, it's changing a lot, and therefore you need to be able to incorporate the latest standards or the latest government directives or whatever it is. So effectively, in terms of the architecture we have defined, we feel that that's a good way to kind of approach this problematic, to try and deal with this extremely fast moving, complex environment. I mean, we have examples today where, particularly in Europe, the French government announced that they were getting rid of the shutters on charging stations. So that will become a directive in France. And then the German government's announcing that they're going to demand that all charging stations accept credit cards. So you actually, almost on a daily basis, you have either kind of changes, changes in standards, which you have to incorporate, or you have government directives that are coming through. So whatever whatever solution you choose to actually incorporate in a vehicle, for sure, it has to be flexible and you have to be able to update it.
Yeah, we are, it's kind of an interesting social experiment that we're going to be entering into, because most public infrastructure, whether it's parking at a parking meter or parking on the street, it is and has always been somewhat first come, first serve. And so now the question will be, how do you actually begin to change consumer behavior to know that something may have been reserved and you can't just walk up? Or, I mean, we've heard stories of people parking their regular gasoline cars in EV parking spots. So it's definitely a challenge. And I think that, this group is going to be working on that challenge as we kind of grow the number of EV vehicles that are out there. So what do you see are as being some of these growing problems in EV charging and in payment? What do you see are some of the near term challenges? What keeps you up at night in terms of the portion of the ecosystem that you work in?
I'll go just because you mentioned reservations a couple seconds ago. There's been a lot of talk about the pros and cons of reservations. And from an infrastructure standpoint, it sounds great that, hey, I can, reserve my charging location and I can just pull up and plug in. The problem is what happens if someone reserves their slot and they don't show up and then someone else desperately needs a charge? They pull up at this charger, it's empty, but they can't use it because it's technically reserved. So that's a huge problem that for a reservation perspective, we're trying to figure out. I think Giles hit the nail on the head with payment regulations. In the US, there's tons of conversations going on at a high level about requiring credit card readers in every single charging station, which means that the driver doesn't have to be a member of a certain network in order to use stations. But then it kind of excludes people who don't have credit cards. And so there's a whole conversation going on about payment regulations in the US with that. And then lastly, having interoperability between the CPOs and, having one account. So instead of having a ChargePoint, EVgo, EA, Flow, like all these different types of networks accounts, having one account and being able to use that account seamlessly, no matter what charger you're at and where you're at in the country. So those are kind of the three main things I would say that we're working on from an infrastructure perspective.
Great, Ed?
I'd echo the point that Julian just made on the fragmentation of apps and all the different pressures we're putting on consumers to discover where they can charge. Where we're really focused is, okay, how can you bring a service level agreement that the OEMs will put their brand behind, fleets will put their brand behind, and have that complexity be a mix of modern payment technology, modern wayfinding technology, and frankly, a lot of manual process in the background. So leveraging the boots on the ground in a parking operation to enforce, to the point you just made, John, when somebody's got their Ford F-150 parked in an EV spot, how does that get managed? No different than when someone hasn't paid to park in a particular spot. So it's going to be a blend of tech, and process to unlock these SLAs, but you can look for a lot of progress starting really in the next quarter. You'll see some very high profile rollouts in some urban cores where we think this is gonna be the big problem, really the top 40 cities here in the US. And then, you know, obviously, you know, different regions have different profiles, but the urban core is where a lot of the value is going to be unlocked as you move EV charging from an amenity to really a service on demand model.
Giles?
So I think for our sense, it's a bit kind of developing the theme I was talking about. So for us, it's the agility to incorporate the latest changes in standards and kind of features, you know, be that price transparency or whatever the latest feature is. And then also dealing with the legacy, because in this market, you've also got a lot of legacy that doesn't change. And then within that, ensuring that we're trying to guarantee and improve a improved charging experience. I think that's kind of, in a nutshell, what we are trying to achieve. And clearly for us, we're very much into the payment side. So we are very much trying to drive the adoption of a payment method that kind of gives a seamless experience for drivers.
Great. Boris, what are your thoughts?
Well, I think the standard parts is, it would be, you know, a big challenge in general, having to deal with different regulation in different parts. So that would take a lot of, it will be costly, I think. I mean, at the end, it won't be like very hard technically, it should be very costly. So it will get a lot of resistance. I think the privacy data on the EVSC and on the in the EV cloud part of the EVSC, it will be an issue, especially for payments. The EVSCs will be handled PIIs, and they will have to store it somehow. We did some of that in the past, you and I, John, and you know, having to deal with PII, even just to hold it for a few seconds, it will require some kind of probably PCI compliance and stuff. So that will be even more costly. And I think that's probably the second most pressing issue there. And no, finally, I think getting to people to adopt B2G as beyond using the app to charge discharge, but to get the benefits of, you know, being part of a B2G program that would allow you to get rewarded when you provide energy back to the grid. That seems very nice on paper, but you know, it will be hard to implement. It will be hard to convince the OEMs. It will be hard to convince the people that they want to be part of this, and one of these programs. And I think that will take also time and money.
Yeah, how has the collaboration been across the industry? What are some of the things that could improve? I mean, we are in this use case and this new product line from OEMs, we're basically building a new kind of industry here or group of industry, having different groups of industry work together. So what could improve? What could be done better to collaborate to move things forward? Ed, any thoughts on that? I know that you work probably large both with public and private government agencies
What I'd add there is there's three different players here, and the standards have to flow for it to be a great consumer experience. So firstly, you have to integrate with the landowner and, you know, make sure that you make a smart choice on the type and level of charger, and then have a management approach to keep that infrastructure alive, working. If you're going to enforce it, you've got to make sure that there's SLAs in place for how that's being managed. You've got to manage, as we talk about it, reservations versus drive up, like Julian mentioned earlier. Then as you roll up to the consumer, they've got to have their own interface as well as the in-vehicle interface. You've got to use all the modern payment capabilities. You've got to use the modern wayfinding capabilities. So, you know, our decade of figuring this out in parking has allowed us to move really fast when it comes to those partner consumer interfaces and leveraging both payment and wayfinding rails that have been, you know, built and put through their paces. So, you know, this pattern looks very familiar. It's really for us how do we scale this capability with capabilities that are already in place.
Anything that you would any specific thing that you would want from one particular person to to improve or
for easier? I think for OEMs, this is their birthright. They have got to get this right. They have a ton at stake. They're betting the future of their companies on EV, and my worry about the approach right now is it is completely siloed. So here I am, I buy this vehicle and I'm doing what I normally do, and I'm expected to worry about EV in an app. I've got to worry about EV in, you know, how I'm going to find my way to these charging. If we can unlock the signal from the vehicle, tie that into the wayfinding in dash, and then tie that to where the consumer's going and the life they're leading, this actually just becomes a natural extension of their day versus an interruption or something that you're asking the consumer to do the heavy lifting. So, you know, OEMs have not nailed the consumer infotainment and payment experience globally. Nobody's got it right. So it's a huge opportunity to make this right, given the resources that are going towards this, both from a consumer spend as well as an investment that OEMs are making.
Great, thanks. Julian, so how's collaboration been on your side? Are you or are you just putting out chargers as fast as you can?
You know, it's I would kind of echo a lot of what Ed just reiterated as far as the payment issue. From an OEM perspective, I agree that the navigation inside the vehicle to get to the chargers is a huge, would definitely kind of make the whole transition to finding infrastructure easier. The problem that we have seen with OEMs when they're trying to integrate that with as an infotainment option is that I think it's something like 86 or 87% of the drivers are using either Google Maps or Apple Maps. And so the navigation system inside the actual vehicle isn't utilized a lot at today. And then in addition to that, there's a PII, there's personal information that there's data security, and there's a lot of data issues that OEMs struggle with in you know finding out with third parties where these people are going, and then the charging information as far as charging sessions, time of charge, like payment methods, all that stuff. So I think those are kind of like the two main, from an OEM perspective in navigation and payments for EVs, those are kind of two main things that I've personally worked on and have seen challenges in the industry.
Thanks. Thanks, Julian. So Giles, that sounds like your cue.
Yeah, it doesn't it? Except I'm going to take it at a slightly higher level. I mean, if I look at our interaction with OEMs, the key in a sense is the how they manage software. I mean, the car is becoming basically the most important and complex bit is the software bit, and traditionally they're more kind of mechanical electronic engineers, and the whole area of how they manage kind of updates of software, over the air updates, while ensuring safety. And I think the frameworks that they have today are probably not optimized for kind of the fast moving world of software. So I think from our perspective, you know, if there was, it's not easy, but that would help us hugely if the OEs worked a bit more like technology companies, with kind of continuous integration, and you know, you're kind of updating the features and the every, you know, whenever it's needed, but every 3 months you've got new stuff coming through, you know, and it's all done in a kind of seamless way. That would certainly help us in terms of a kind of infrastructure to allow us to be able to innovate and ensure that we're introducing the latest stuff at the right time. Because today, basically, the way the system works is we tend to be out of date. So that would be my core kind of message. And I think a lot of the OEs, you know, if you look at Volkswagen, BMW, all these companies, they clearly recognize that. They're working on it. They're introducing new stuff and they're doing some great stuff. But I think that's something where there's still a lot of work to do in terms of making and that for EV is even more kind of more important just because of the nature of the market and how fast it's moving and how many changes we have to incorporate in the different countries in the world.
Yeah, I think the good news there is that there is investment being made. There is R&D dollars being applied to it. Boris, you know, everybody's been pointing at the OEM. Not to put you on the spot.
I think that the best OEMs can do is understand that they should become software companies. I don't think beyond Tesla, the Chinese electric car companies have actually done that successfully. And I think that's the core. If you go to the details, you see that there will come improvements, basic stuff. For example, like protocols like OBD2, that is still being used to, you know, communicate, can be significantly improved, and to allow the car to communicate with the infotainment and, you know, eventually with telemetry. And but that only will happen if you start seeing the vehicle as a software platform. I think that will be something that will significantly improve the approach to V2G or to electrification. Just a final example: the communication using 5011A between vehicle and EVSE requires a lot of low level communication, like a lot of, you know, energy and very cryptic stuff happening on the background. So a lot of that information can be used by the vehicle, but it's only being used for the communication. It cannot be leveraged for many vehicles because that layer of abstraction between this very low level information to the high level information of the vehicle is limited, but because it's using very legacy software, very old software. So I mean, the software can be new, but the paradigm is kind of old. So once the vehicle becomes a more powerful software platform, they will be able to, get access to all this information that been coming from the grid or from the EVSE or from the, from the environment. Even so, that I think that will be the best from the OEMs, the best next step to do to embrace software as a part of the core business.
Great. Well, I think it's safe to say that everyone on this on this panel is would be actually eager to work with anyone in the EV ecosystem. So please feel free to reach out to either myself or Mike, and we can get you connected to this folk. It seems to be a very growing area and an area based on everyone's commitment to EVs, whether it's from the OEs or government or municipalities. It's a growing area. So I just want to thank the panelists for joining us today. Any last parting words for our audience? Okay.
No. Great. Got nothing. Thanks for having us.
Thank you, John, for the invitation.
Great. Thank you. Thank you for joining us.